Is it necessary to belong to a certain church to be saved? Or is it necessary to belong to any church to be saved? What does the Bible say? Stay tuned to find out.
The Steps to Life Prophecy Seminar will take you on a journey through the Bible, explaining prophecies and symbols that have confused men for centuries. Daniel, Revelation, the Beast, the Mark of Antichrist, the Mystery of Babylon. Grab your Bible and a pen as we turn the pages of God's Holy Bible.
Steps to Life is opening God's Word with you.
Jesus is coming again. Are you ready for His soon return?
Jesus Christ is always what we'll share with you.
We need a refreshing, so drink. Jesus is the water of life.
Steps to Life, a work of love, a work of love.
He created this earth and wants to recreate you.
He can change.
Thank you for joining us. We're going to open God's holy book and search for the truth in Bible prophecy. But before we do that, we need the Holy Spirit to guide us. We're going to look at a truth today that, because of misunderstanding this truth, millions and millions of people have been killed in the past. Let us ask the Lord to help us understand it as we open His Word. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for Bible prophecy that shows us the truth, that lights up the way where we live and shows us what to do, and explains to us the meaning of the times in which we're living and what is about to happen in the future. We humbly pray that you will teach us the truth from your word and that you will give us a heart to obey and follow you, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Welcome to the Steps to Life Prophecy Seminar. We would like to send you a free study pack, including a study guide and audio cassette of today's subject, as well as a free book entitled Lost in Church. To receive your free gifts, simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. You might be attending a wonderful church, be involved with many activities, surrounded by friends of like faith. But did you know that many such people will come to the last days and find that they are lost? Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and request offer number 42. And now, Pastor John Grossbaugh.
Do you have to belong to a church to be saved? Or do you have to belong to a certain church to be saved? In the past, millions and millions of Bible-believing Christians have been killed, martyred, many of them tortured, because others said, "You don't belong to the right church. You don't belong to our church. And so you must either belong to our church or lose your life." Now, we have seen in a previous session in this prophecy seminar that in the end of the world, there will only be two great churches. Of course, as now, there will be many, many different organizations, but the question is, if you live until the end of the world, will you have to belong to a church to be saved? Let's ask the question, first of all, for the past. Do you have to belong, or did you have to belong, to a church in Bible times if you were going to be saved? Before answering this question, perhaps a preliminary question needs to be answered first, and that is, who and what is the church anyway? In Acts the 7th chapter, verse 38, Stephen is speaking, and he talks about God's people back in the days of Moses, the children of Israel back in the wilderness, and he refers to them as the church in the wilderness. God has always had a church. Ever since the time of Adam and Eve and Abel and Seth, God has always had a church, that is, the people who have followed Him and were chosen by Him as His covenant people. And being part of this people resulted in receiving the covenant promises and blessings. And what were these covenant promises and blessings? We read about it in Genesis, the 17th chapter. God is speaking to Abraham, and God says in verse 7, "I will establish my covenant between me and you and your descendants after you and their generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and your descendants after you." Verse 8, "Also I give to you and your descendants after you the land in which you are a stranger, all the land of Canaan, as an everlasting possession, and I will be their God." And then, It talks about the conditions and terms of the covenant. And the sign of the covenant in Old Testament times was circumcision. That was a sign. And that's talked about here also in Genesis, the 17th chapter. The New Testament enlarges a great deal on this promise to Abraham and shows that this promise to Abraham is going to be fulfilled through the Christian church. Notice what the Apostle Paul said about it. And here in Romans, the 4th chapter, he talks about how Abraham actually was promised the whole world. This whole world has been called Abraham's farm, Canaan, the land of Canaan, the headquarters. Here in Romans, the 4th chapter, Paul is writing about Abraham, and it says, starting in verse 13, "For the promise that he would be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law." In other words, not through his descendants according to the flesh, "but through the righteousness of faith. For if those who are of the law are heirs, faith is made void and the promise made of no effect." Remember, this promise was not to be fulfilled through Ishmael. It was to be fulfilled through the Son of Promise. It was to be fulfilled by the miracle child that God would give to Abraham, showing that it was not to be fulfilled through the flesh. Ishmael was circumcised, as you can read in Genesis 17:35. But the fulfillment of the promise did not come through him. Notice what it says here. "If those who are of the law are heirs, faith is made void and the promise made of no effect, because the law brings about wrath. For where there is no law, there is no transgression. Therefore it is of faith, that it might be according to grace, so that the promise," this is the covenant promise, "might be sure to all the seed, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who are of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all." If you're a Christian, if you follow Christ, as Paul said in Galatians 3:29, if you're Christ's, then you are Abraham's seed. You are heirs according to the promise. That's the covenant promise. Verse 17 says, "As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations, in the presence of him whom he believed, even God who gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did." So, God made covenant promises to Abraham, those that were his descendants spiritually, not the descendants according to the law or according to the flesh, those that were his descendants spiritually, those that were the children of faith, as he was a child of faith, those are the ones that would receive the covenant promises. Notice what Paul says about it again in Hebrews 6 and 11. It says in Hebrews 6, 13 and 14, "For when God made a promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no one greater, he swore by himself, saying, surely blessing I will bless you, and multiplying I will multiply you." And then in Hebrews the 11th chapter, verses 8 to 10, it says, "By faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place which he would afterward receive as an inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he was going. By faith he sojourned in the land of promise, as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God." He was waiting. He was waiting for the New Jerusalem. He was waiting for that eternal inheritance that had been promised to him and to his spiritual descendants. And those spiritual descendants became the covenant people, the church, and the people that accepted the Messiah continued on as the covenant people, the church. They received the fulfillment of the covenant of promise. The old covenant had within it the shadow or the type of the new covenant. And those that accepted the Messiah and his death on the cross as their one and only sacrifice for sin, they went on and became the covenant people, the descendants of Abraham, the true descendants of Abraham, the spiritual descendants of Abraham, the Christian church. There were people in the Old Testament times, however, who did not belong to God's church, who were not part of his special covenant, people who will still be saved. We read about this in the Bible itself. For instance, in Psalm 87, it says in verses 4 to 6, "I will make mention of Rahab and Babylon to those who know me. Behold, O Philistia and Tyre with Ethiopia, this one was born there. And of Zion it will be said, this one and that one were born in her. and the Most High himself shall establish her. The Lord will record when he registers the peoples. This one was born there. So there will be people in the kingdom of heaven from Old Testament times, not only from the covenant people, but those. It talks about those who know me, that is, those that know the Lord, those that follow and they obey him according to all the knowledge they have. People from Babylon, it says, will be saved. People from Philistia will be saved. That's the Philistines, the enemies of Israel. People from Tyre, one of the most wicked cities of antiquity. And yet there will be people from Tyre. There will be people from Babylon. There will be people from Philistia that will be saved in the kingdom of heaven, although they were never part of God's church in this world. These were people who did not belong to God's church on earth, but they will be made a part of the church triumphant at the end of the world and will inherit the covenant blessings. Jesus predicted very plainly that this would occur. We read the words of Jesus on this very subject in Matthew, the 8th chapter. He's talking concerning the covenant people who thought that since they were Jews and Abraham's seed, that they would be saved and nobody else would. And notice what Jesus said to them. He made it plain that it was character and not profession that counted. It was not your blood lineage, but it was your spiritual lineage that determined the side you were on. Notice what Jesus says here in Matthew, the 8th chapter, verses 10 to 12. It says, when Jesus heard it, that's the Roman centurion. He was not an Israelite. And it says, he marveled and said to those who followed, assuredly, I say to you, I have not found so great faith, not even in Israel. And I say to you that many will come from east and west and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of the kingdom will be cast out into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So, Jesus said, there will be many that will come from the east and west, from all over the world. They were not in the church in this world, but they developed a character that God approved. It's the pure in heart that will see God, Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount. It's the merciful who will receive mercy. It's those who follow the teachings of God that they heard and understood. Those are the ones that develop a character in harmony with God's law. Those are the ones that will be saved. You see, it's character and not profession that counts. And so Jesus predicted that many would come from the east and the west, people that have never been part of the church in this world, but they would join and become part of the church triumphant. You see, the thing that's always mattered to God is a person's heart. We read about this in Romans, the 10th chapter, and it says here, Romans, the 10th chapter, it says, for with the heart one believes to righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made to salvation. For the Scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. It's not talking here about an intellectual belief. It's talking about a belief from the heart. You have put your whole self on the line to dedicate yourself, to trust yourself to God. It says, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. There have been many, many people in past ages who have believed in the Lord, who have followed him, who have obeyed him according to all the light and knowledge they have had, who will be saved although they were not a part of the church in this world. They will be part of the church triumphant. For Jesus predicted, many will come from the east and the west and sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. In fact, not only is it true that there will be many people that never belonged to the church in this world who will be saved because they developed a character that God approved, and that's one of the main teachings that you read all through the parables of Jesus. One of the main teachings of Jesus throughout the Gospels is the fact that your character determines your destiny. So there will be many people who have not been part of the church of this world who will join the church triumphant. In fact, it is dangerous to think that people must belong to a certain church organization or that they cannot be saved. This teaching in the past has resulted in the torture and death of millions of martyrs. And this idea is severely rebuked by Jesus himself. Notice what Jesus said to his apostles, to his disciples, in Mark, the 9th chapter, verses 37 and 38. It says, "Whoever receives one of these little children in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me." Now John answered him, saying, "Teacher, we saw someone who does not follow us casting out demons in your name, and we forbade him because he does not follow us." Have you ever heard someone say, "Well, it's important that your church be apostolic"? Well, if there ever was an apostolic church, this would be it. These were the 12 apostles. They had been ordained by Jesus himself. This was the apostolic church. This was the 12 apostles, and they were organized, and they found somebody that didn't belong to their church organization, that didn't belong to their group, and so they forbid this person to work miracles in Christ's name. Did Jesus approve of that? Does Jesus approve of anybody saying, "You don't belong to the right church organization. The right organization is us, and if you don't belong to us, then you're going to be lost"? Notice what Jesus says about sectarianism. Verses 39 and 40. But Jesus said, "Do not forbid him. For no one works a miracle in my name can soon afterwards speak evil of me. For he who is not against us is on our side." So Jesus forbid the 12 apostles to command everybody to join their church organization and tell somebody who did not belong to them, "Well, you can't do any work for the Lord. You can't work in Jesus' name. You can't be a follower of his." No, Jesus forbid that kind of thing. He says, don't forbid him. Let him be. You see, there were people in Jesus' day that were working for Jesus, that were doing his will, that were leading people to him, that evidently did not belong to the apostolic church. They weren't following the 12 apostles. Now, the early church had the same problem. The Corinthian church had the same problem. Notice what Paul says about it in 1 Corinthians 3. He says, "And I, brethren, could not speak to you as to spiritual people, but as to carnal, as to babes in Christ. I fed you with milk and not with solid food, for until now you were not able to receive it, and even now you are still not able, for you are still carnal. For where there are envy, strife, and divisions among you, are you not carnal and behaving like mere men? For when one says, 'I am of Paul,' and another, 'I am of Apollos,' are you not carnal?" And he goes on to talk in the first chapter about, of 1 Corinthians, how that there were some saying, "Well, I'm of Peter." Some people say, "Peter started my church. Peter's the head of my church." Somebody else says, "Well, Paul started my church. He's the head of my church." Somebody else says, "Well, Apollos was the greatest teacher. He's the one that I'm following." Paul says, as long as you're talking that way, you're not even converted. You're still carnal. That's resulting in strife and divisions among you. True unity can only come when a person decides to follow the Lord Jesus all the way and obey him and do his will. And when you choose to follow Jesus and you're taught and you choose to do his will, you're baptized, then you become part of what the New Testament calls the body of Christ, Colossians 1:24. But as we draw near the end of this world's history, two things are going to happen. First of all, there's going to be a movement to get all the churches together to worship the image to the beast, as you can read about in Revelation 13. And this movement is going to be so successful that almost everybody in the world will worship the image to the beast. They will think they're worshiping Christ when they're worshiping Antichrist. Over and over again, the book of Revelation reveals that in the last days, almost the whole world is going to be deceived by Antichrist. You can read it in Romans and in Revelation. You can read it in Revelation 12, 9, Revelation 13, 8, Revelation 13, 14, Revelation 16, 12 and 13, Revelation 18, 23. In other words, over and over and over again. This is why it says in Revelation 1, 7 that when Jesus actually comes, the peoples of this world are going to wail because of him. Almost all the world is going to be deceived. And here are the two points that they're going to be deceived about. Stay tuned and see what they are.
We at Steps to Life are committed to helping you better understand the Bible and prepare for future events. We would like to send you a free study pack, including a study guide and audio cassette of today's subject, "Do You Have to Belong to a Church to Be Saved?" and our new book entitled, "Lost in Church." The last trumpet sounds, Christ descends to deliver his faithful servants, and you find that he has not come for you. How could this be? Haven't you done many things for him? Have you not devoted your life to the church? How could you be lost in church? The Bible talks about this very thing happening. Call now for your free copy of our new book, Lost in Church. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. When you call, ask for details on how to obtain your very own prophecy seminar binder to organize the studies you receive. Simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-THE-TRUTH. And make sure when you call that you ask for offer number 42.
Welcome back. The two points on which evil spirits are going to deceive almost the entire world in the last days are, number one, the idea that you can communicate with people that have already died. And people are doing that today by the millions, and the Bible forbids it. In fact, the Bible teaches that it's impossible. It's a fraud every time it happens. It's actually somebody else than you think that is perfectly impersonating who you think you're talking to. That's the first point of deception on which the whole world is going to be deceived, and it is being deceived right now. And then the second point on which evil spirits will deceive the whole world. And this system is called Babylon because they break the law of God and teach people to break the law of God, as you can read in Revelation 18:4. And the idea that God's law can be changed or altered is the second point on which evil spirits will deceive almost the whole world. And they will think that they're worshiping Christ, but they are actually worshiping Antichrist. That is one of the things that is going to happen as we approach the end of this world's history. But a second thing is also going to happen. There is going to be a revival and reformation movement, a movement of Bible religion among all the peoples of the world, among all those that want to be saved and are willing to follow whatever the Bible says. This movement, which will be worldwide, is described in Revelation 14, verses 6 to 12, and again in Revelation 18, 1 to 5. These verses describe a worldwide movement. And they describe a warning which is given to the multitudes of this world concerning the danger of setting aside any part of the law of God. Also, these verses in Revelation 14 describe the people who will be ready to meet Jesus when He comes again. And they reveal that these people will be keeping God's commandments and that they will have the faith of Jesus, as you read in Revelation 14, 12. When Jesus comes again, there will not be three classes of people in the world like there are today. Those people who are serving Satan, those people who are serving the Lord, and those people that are in the valley of decision and haven't totally made up their mind yet. Everybody at that time will be in one group or the other. They will have fully made up their minds to accept the three angels' messages, and as a result, they will compose the group described in Revelation 14:12. Or they will have fully made up their minds to reject the three angels' messages, and as a result, they will take part in what will appear to them as the greatest revival and reformation movement of all time, only to find out at the end that they have been worshiping the Antichrist instead of the true Christ, because they have attempted communication with the dead and were attempting to adjust or change God's law. If a person accepts the three angels' messages, Revelation 14, 6 to 12, they will become part of the worldwide group of people from every denomination, language, and nation, people who are doing the same thing. And all of these people will, at the end of time, form one church, which will become triumphant during the end of the world. That is the focal point of the latter part of the book of Revelation. The three angels' messages are the focal point of the latter part of the book of Revelation. You have the three angels' messages in chapter 14, verses 6 to 12. Then you have the seven last plagues. But who receives the seven last plagues? That's chapters 15 and 16. The people that receive the seven last plagues, as is made very clear in Revelation 16, verse 2, are those that have not accepted the third angel's message. And then there is the judgment on Babylon in Revelation 17 and 18. And what's that all about? Well, that's about what's going to happen to those who give their power to the beast, who reject the three-angel angel's message and worship and serve the beast power or the Antichrist power. And then you have the last call out of Babylon in Revelation 18. And then you have the coming of Christ in Revelation 19, and some people, when Jesus comes, are going to be destroyed. And who are they going to be? the people that will be destroyed from the last generation will be those that have been deceived by Antichrist and who have been worshiping the beast and receiving his mark, as you read in Revelation 19:20. And then you have the millennium. And who is going to be up in heaven during the millennium? And who is going to be dead during the millennium? You can read about that in Revelation 20, verse 4. Those that are with Christ during the millennium will be those that have not been worshiping the beast or his image or receiving his mark, as you read in Revelation 20, verse 4. You see, the entire latter part of the book of Revelation has as its focal point the three angels' messages. And so the last half of the book of Revelation is devoted to a description of two classes of people, those who accept the third angel's message, and as a result are described in Revelation 14:12 as those that keep the commandments and have the faith of Jesus, and those that reject the three angels' messages, and as a result they receive the mark of Antichrist. Over and over again it is pointed out in Revelation that whether you accept the three angels' messages will determine your eternal destiny during the end of the world. It will determine the church that you belong to at the end of the world. The people worldwide who accept the three angels' messages will all belong to a church described in Revelation 12:17, and again in Revelation 19, verses 7 and 8. But those that reject the three angels' messages will lose their soul. And those people are also described in the latter part of the book of Revelation in chapters 17, 18, 19, and 20. So, the question is, what is going to happen to you as we approach the end of time? Do you understand, friend, that as we get closer and closer to the end of time, it becomes more and more critical whether you have accepted the three angels' messages or not? The three angels' message involves, first of all, the proclamation of the everlasting gospel, the proclamation that the hour of God's judgment has come and that we should fear God and worship Him as the Creator. In fact, the first angel's message quotes right out of the fourth commandment. Those that accept the three angels' messages will be keeping the fourth commandment as well as all the other commandments, as you read in Revelation 14, 6 and 7 and 9 to 12. Then there's a warning against false worship. There's a warning against teaching people to break God's law. And there's a warning against worshiping the beast, his image, and his mark. Your destiny at the end of the world will be determined by one very simple fact if you will live until the end of the world, and that is this. Have you accepted the three angels' messages and you're keeping the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus? Or have you rejected them and as a result, you're worshiping the Antichrist? There's no other way to go, friend. Everybody in the whole world is going to be in one camp or the other. The question is, where are you going to be? The answer is determined by the decision that you make day by day today. Who are you going to follow?
We hope you have enjoyed today's prophecy seminar on Do You Have to Belong to a Church to Be Saved? We would like to send you a free study pack, including a study guide and audio cassette of today's subject, as well as our new book entitled Lost in Church. Simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. How is it possible for someone to attend church faithfully, teach the lessons, sing in the choir, help the poor, visit the sick, and still be lost? Do these good deeds not account for something toward our salvation? How can we prevent this terrible fate from becoming ours? Is there not some way we can be certain that we will not be lost? Does the Bible say anything about people in this condition? If I am in this condition, how do I get out? Discover what God has to say about those who will be lost in church. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH now, and make sure when you call that you ask for offer number 42. Tune in next week for The Only Way to Be Saved. You don't want to miss this vital message. If you are in the Wichita area and are looking for a church family, you are invited to join us for worship and fellowship every Saturday at 11 a.m.
Steps to Life.
We hope you have been as blessed by today's message as we have been in bringing it to you. We encourage you to contact us at Steps to Life Ministries with any questions or comments you might have.
Check 1-2, check 1-2.
Don't forget to ask for today's free offer.
Ready in 5-4.
Steps to Life Ministries, preparing a people for the soon coming of Jesus Christ.
Welcome, friends.
He can change your life.